I would say it was definitely more nuanced because, like Diop, for instance, he talks about in pre-colonial Black Africa how the invasion, like the Islamic invasions, happened in North Africa, but he says as far as going south of the Sahara Desert, that never happened. It's just like he calls it a figment of like sociologist imagination or something like that.
New math is with my motherfucker's ass. You wanna know how to rhyme, you better learn how to add. It's mathematics.
Mighty most definitely.
It's simple mathematics. Check it out. I'll revolve around science.
What are we talking about here?
Peace, peace, peace. It's Rakim with Wiser Dome TV. Today I have a very special guest, MC, researcher, a brother about his people and the liberation of all original people. Slank, I appreciate you for coming through, G.
Well, thanks for having me on here.
No doubt, no doubt, man. So I'd like to begin, like, well, what sparked you getting knowledge yourself? What led you on your path?
Yeah, I would say just like, I'm from Kentucky, so just growing up, I experienced a lot of racism as a kid. And also my dad's a lot older than me. He's born in the 40s. So he grew up in Jim Crow and just learning stuff from him. And that made me aware of everything that was going on. And then after that, when I was about 14, that's when I read Malcolm X's autobiography. And that really opened me up to everything else and just got me studying more, reading a lot. And I eventually ended up majoring in African history in undergrad. And so just kept studying after that.
How was your experience studying African history in undergrad? And where did you go to college?
I went to University of Notre Dame in Indiana. But I mean, I had a positive experience because it opened me up to a lot of things that I didn't learn in on my own or even high school at all. Like for instance, like Patrice Lumumba, I learned about him when I was an undergrad. And from there, I went and read a whole lot more about the Congo, about Lumumba, and everything else. So.
For sure. Now, I want to ask you something. Do you consider yourself Pan-African?
Yeah, I would consider myself Pan-African.
No doubt, no doubt. And so with that said, you were just recently in a discussion called Do Abrahamic Religions Compromise African Liberation the other day. It was very, very good discussion between everybody. I definitely enjoyed it and appreciated all the perspectives. With it being the week of Malcolm X's birthday, I've seen some, and even on the debate itself, where it was implied that Malcolm would have grown out of Islam if he would have, lived long enough. What are your thoughts on that type of sentiment that says, you know, some of our heroes of the past who may have been religious did what they did in spite of their religion and not necessarily inspired by their religion?
Yeah, like you said, that was brought up in the discussion as well by some people. And there was like a lot of things that were said that I didn't necessarily agree with, but that was definitely the one that one of the things that I definitely mainly didn't agree with was that the implication that Malcolm would have like outgrown Islam or had he had more knowledge, because I feel like it was implying that the people saying this felt that they were on like a higher plane than Malcolm X. And yeah, I just don't agree with that because it was a very huge part of his life and also his development. If it wasn't for Islam, we wouldn't know Malcolm X as Malcolm X, because that's what transformed him when he was in prison. He became the person that we know him as. And so, yeah, I totally disagree with that sentiment.
Right. And if you look at who his teacher was, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, his teachers cleans a lot of different people up who have been in the spotlight. And it's safe to say that that's what his teachers did for people. You know what I mean? Especially during those times where, there were a lot of, we have civil unrest now, but the 60s was a special time, you know, where a lot of different things were happening globally and domestically. And to see, you know, what Elijah Muhammad's teachers were doing for people, Malcolm was one of the many, you know what I mean? He was obviously powerful in his own right. And you said before that, You know, his book helped, you know, get you on the path to knowledge itself. A lot of people are familiar, obviously, with Malcolm's autobiography written by Alex Haley. But there are a lot of dope books that have been written about Malcolm. And for those who, you know, want to study Malcolm more, do you recommend any other books about Malcolm's life?
Definitely. I got some over here. I would definitely recommend Malcolm X Speaks. This one right here. It's like a collection of his speeches and whatnot. But it shows there's so much material in here. Some of his most famous speeches, like Message to Grassroots and whatnot's in there.
Right.
This one right here is called Malcolm X on Afro-American History. That one also, that has more of a focus on African, like his takes on Africa and whatnot.
Okay.
Now I like that one a lot because there's a quote on the back. He says, when we send our children to school, they learn nothing about us other than that we used to be cotton pickers. While your grandfather was Nat Turner, your grandfather was Toussaint Louverture, your grandfather was Hannibal. And he's just talking about how, like, even, and he mentioned a Hannibal, he's showing that, like, our history is much further than just, you know, enslavement in America and everything. Right. So I like that one a lot, too.
Yeah, yeah. And that reminds me of, like, how a lot of, you know, people within the Eidos movement sound like, I mean, they speak from a perspective of our history and our identity being defined here in America. And I mean, I know you've seen some of those, you know, comments and a lot of from the Eidos movement. What are your thoughts on it, man?
Completely disagree with them. A lot of their takes are really confused to me. I think they're lost, a lot of them, because like the fight for reparations, you know, everybody supports that, like, well, not everybody, but you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, within that, within like the Black movement, various types of ideology support reparations. But when you link it to like trying to claim America and trying to distance yourself from other Africans and stuff, that's not the way to go about it at all. Like, if anything, we should try to be getting closer to Africans in the diaspora and on the continent and whatnot, not like alienating ourselves. And yeah, they go against a lot of what Malcolm, like, like pretty much, you can find a Malcolm X quote to like go against anything the ADOS, people say.
And it's funny though you say that, because I've seen him cherry pick certain Malcolm quotes.
Yeah,
and it sounds like he is agreeing with something they said, but they won't post the whole quote though, you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. I've seen a whole lot of people take Malcolm and use him for all kind of different ideological things they're trying to do. But I would say if you read like Malcolm X Speaks or whatever, you get a pretty clear understanding of like what he was on, like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, indeed. And you know, back, not to harp on the ADOS point, but there's also a book, it's called The Diary of, I believe The Diary of Malcolm X, 1964. And it's each chapter is about, is him, like whenever he went to London, whenever he went to Ghana, you know, and like Malcolm was showing and proving that he had a global mind state when it comes to the liberation of Black people. You know what I mean? And it wasn't just a domestic thing with him. You know what I mean? Because, and we look now, like, I feel like even with what's going on in Palestine, right? Like, U.S. imperialism affects the entire world. And imperialism and racism and white supremacy go hand in hand. And to think that we'll be able to get a reparations check, right, and think that everything is over, and then start living our lives within a capitalistic society, like everything is fine. Like, to me, I don't see the logic in it.
Is one of his main points is that revolution is about land too. And like, if ADOS, if you're just trying to be part of American society, that's not really like getting, I don't know. I'm not really sure on their exact position on the land thing, but I don't think it's, I've seen ADOS make fun of like the Republic of New Africa or like stuff like that. So I don't know. where they're coming from, but
me either, bro. I did want to speaking of Pan-Africanism, a lot of things I've had discussions online with a lot of people, and I think a lot are confused of what Pan-Africanism truly is. What does Pan-African mean to you? If somebody were, you know, like slang, I want to study my people, I want to study my history, I also want to get active, I want to have a political ideology that's, you know, in tune with our liberation. Can you tell me what Pan-Africanism is? Like, what would be your response?
Yeah, if I would define it the way like Kwame Ture, Kwame Nkrumah, Sekou Ture, how they define it, kind of like the total unification and liberation of the African continent under scientific socialism. Mm. And even going further than that, there's a really good speech by Kwame Ture from 1971. Mm-hmm. I think it was like Whittier College in California. It's online. It's like American radio. I forget the exact URL, but I can send it to you.
Okay.
You
know?
He basically outlines his concept of Pan-Africanism and calls himself an Nkrumahist, talking about Kwame Nkrumah and how he kind of patterns himself on the conscientism. That's hard words. That kind of ideology of he breaks it down as it has, like, the ideology has to be about race, class, lands, and it has to be revolutionary and based on dialectics, which is like the law of opposites and like the correct interpretation of history. So it's got to be a scientific ideology that's based on Pan-Africanism, Pan meaning all, so like all Africans, and trying to get all Africans united on the same page so we can combat Western imperialism and all the forces that are trying to divide Africa and have divided Africa.
Great answer, bro. And I mean, yeah, and so I think one thing about that quote that stood out to me is the use of the word scientific socialism, right? As opposed to utopian socialism, where we feel like we will vote our way out of oppression or white supremacy will just begin to change. And I haven't seen any evidence of that. So, you know what I'm saying? I do understand. And so whenever we, that kind of leads me to this question as well. So being Pan-African, do you feel like socialism is the ultimate goal of society?
Because I define socialism as like when the masses own and control the means of production, or like, mm-hmm. Like control their own resources and everything like that, versus capitalism, the other economic system, is when just a few people own and control the means of production. So yeah, I would say, because even if you have political independence, if you still have, like we see today all over Africa, with like a lot of these neo-colonial leaders and stuff, they're still economically selling out their people for their own benefit and to the West, you know what I'm saying? So I definitely think socialism is important, because capitalism is what divided Africa. So I feel like you have to do the antithesis too.
Right. Yeah, it did. It like, you know, even, so I want to kind of touch on that. And so do you feel like we can ever be free and live and truly liberated within a capitalist society? I'll give you some context. Reason I asked is right now I'm currently reading a book. I don't have it in here, but it's by Frank Chapman. It's called Marxist-Leninist Perspectives on Black Liberation and Socialism. And, you know, it talks about different people from Frederick Douglass to Hubert Harrison to W.E.B. Du Bois, who at times expressed socialist ideas. And, on the other hand, you have Marcus Garvey, who clearly had, you know, capitalist ideas while he was in America. And so do you feel like now we have, you know, we have rich Black people in America and throughout the country, but that's not necessarily a reflective of the whole, you know what I mean? Do you feel like that we can truly be liberated under capitalism? Like, is that capitalism the answer?
No, I don't feel like black capitalism is the answer at all. And I don't feel like we can fully get liberation. Like, you can have a strata of the of black people that get, you know, a little bit higher or whatever, but that's at the expense of the masses. And what's his name? Robert L. Allen, I think it's, yeah. He had a Black Awakening in Capitalist America. Mm. He wrote a book that was talking about how toward like the late 60s, once like the Black Power revolts and things started happening in all kind of different cities, how like the white power structure kind of, they changed their strategy basically, mm-hmm. and started putting money and investing in black capitalist initiatives. Like Richard Nixon was real influential in pushing black capitalism, and he was, there was like the Ford Foundation was pumping money into organizations like CORE to try to divert them from a more revolutionary perspective to a more black capitalist perspective, because the black capitalist perspective didn't really challenge the status quo in the system. It was seeking more to get into it than try to change it or rebuild it or anything like that.
Agreed. What was the name of that book again?
I got it right here in the family. Black Awakening in Capitalist America.
Yeah, I actually had that in one of my lists somewhere. So yeah, definitely. I'm definitely gonna cop that. And so with, you know, speaking of like imperialism and like just US imperialism and Western imperialism, we see what's going on in Palestine and the continued Nakba of the people. And for those who don't know what Zionism is, would you be able to kind of explain what Zionism is politically?
Yeah. So like the main thing is you got to like distinguish it from Judaism, because what they try to do is they try to link the two together. Mm-hmm. Zionism, because Judaism is an ancient religion, you know what I'm saying? It comes from Africa. There's books on that too about how the origins of Judaism come out of Africa. But Zionism is totally different. It comes from Europe. 1897 was like the first Zionist conference, where a dude named Theodore Herzl, it's the philosophy that underpins like the state of Israel. It's the idea that God gave them this land, and so that they have the right to go in there and take it from whoever was there. And from early on, Theodore Herzl, who's seen as the father of Zionism, at that first conference, he tried to link himself to imperialism. So like, I got a book I was reading the other day. I just started it. It's called The Zionist Connection by Alfred M. Lilienthal. And he talks about how, I just seen it the other day, originally Theodore Herzl went to Germany. Mm-hmm. He went to the Ottoman Empire asking, yo, I got this plan to set up this national home, state of Israel, whatever, in Palestine. And they wasn't feeling it. So he eventually went over to the British, and they agreed to do that. And they wrote a Balfour Declaration. It was like mm-hmm. a British politician, Lord Balfour, in 1917. Britain basically, after the First World War, the Ottoman Empire's different colonies or whatever got split up. Britain was colonizing Palestine after that. So they say, yeah, we'll give Palestine to the Zionists, because it advantages them too. Because then they have a friendly, Theodore Herzl, this is a European Jewish man. Like, this ain't like a Ethiopian or like a Middle Eastern or nothing like that. So this gives Britain a friendly white home base in the Middle East, and now America too, because America pretty much, you know, proposed that whole thing to do all their, and as Malcolm said, it gives them the base to divide the Africa and Asia and sow dissension in the Arab world and all that. So,
yeah. And that's interesting that you said that. So Theodore Herzl in 1897 had the first Zionist conference, right? Mm-hmm. And it's funny because media tries to give the impression that the reason, like the Israel being well, displacing the people of, you know, Palestine or the Palestinians was due to, you know, World War II and you know, what happened with Hitler and the Jews there and them needing a home, right? And they don't speak of it as if it was, if it had beginnings that are older than that. You know what I mean?
Think about that too. Before the Second World War, most Jewish people in the world were not on board with Zionism. That wasn't a popular outlook. Like, that was only like a handful of like bourgeois Jewish people trying to push this. And it was after the Second World War, or like during it, that they kind of used this as a justification. Because part of the foundation of Zionism is we're inherently different as Jewish people, they would say, and like, we'll never be able to live in peace anywhere but in our own state.
Right.
And that's the same thing that like the Nazis were saying, y'all are inherently different, is what they was telling the Jewish people. You can't live with, like, you know what I'm saying? So they kind of balance with each other, honestly, like fascist ideologies and Zionism. Because at the heart, it's also a imperialist, you know, project.
Yeah. And it's, how much of it is like, so, okay. They give the idea that this is about religion and this was the land of their forefathers, you know, Isaac and the 12 tribes of Jacob, and you know what I mean, and that whole story they give. Is that just a front? You know what I mean? As far like, does Zionism use religion as a front to justify the things that they do over there in the Middle East?
Yeah, I would say absolutely, because that's what they try to do, is link this ancient African religion that has nothing to do with, you know, it's not a, like, yeah, they link this ancient African religion with this modern European philosophy and to try to justify it. So they'll try to, they try to like use religion, but like there's a whole lot of anti-Zionist, like real religious Jewish people that are against Zionism and stuff, because they see it as a perversion of the faith and everything. So they definitely try to link it up. That way it makes it harder to criticize it. Mm-hmm. Talk negative about Israel, they try to label you anti-Semitic.
Right. You know what I'm saying? So like, but you brought up a good point the other day, like, how are the Palestinians not Semitic? What happened to them, how is that not anti-Semitic as well? Or does that only apply to quote unquote white Semites?
Yeah, exactly. Because there's people in Ethiopia is the Semitic. And that's like another point, like about like Semitic languages. They branch. That's an Afro-Asiatic language group. There's Arabic, Hebrew, I think Amharic. There's a number of them that span like East Africa, North Africa, that little West Asia area. So yeah, like the fact that people who are from Europe is like saying you're anti-Semitic for calling them out for killing Semites is kind of like, it's some crazy word games.
But the cold part about it is that it insulates them from any type of criticism, because anytime anybody, especially people that, you know, let's say a politician or a celebrity or somebody that has a really big platform, speaking out about Palestine can cost you your job. I mean, about Israel can cost you your job, and they'll call you, you know, anti-Semitic, and it'll stick. You know, like we've even seen with, you know, like on social media, how they, you know, deplatformed Farrakhan whenever he spoke on Israel. And it's funny because I just thought about that, like, you know, things that he said maybe a year ago, I think during one of those Savior's Day speeches. I mean, we see them really acting it and living it out, you know what I mean, right now in Palestine.
No, definitely. There was I remember back in 2014, Israel had like a war. They was just massacring like Palestinians back then too. And Dwight Howard put out a tweet like, I stand with, like, I don't want to see the suffering in Palestine. Something like, yeah, just something real basic, like, I don't like children getting bombed or something.
Right, right.
And then like an hour later, he had to put up an apology tweet for expressing like humanity. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's crazy just because of how linked they try to make these two things, where like him just saying like, I don't like this violence of little kids and stuff against little kids turns into, oh, you're anti-Semite, you got to delete that tweet and issue a retracted apology.
Have you noticed now, though, like with, I mean, even from everybody from Joe Biden to a lot of celebrities who have spoken out now, how they'll say they're real careful with their words and they'll say things as if you know, we want both sides to come to a peaceful resolution, right? And what I noticed is, first off, that's bull, because you can't ask people who are being oppressed and displaced to not fight back and not protect themselves. That's the, you know, first law of nature is self-preservation. But one thing that I noticed, and I just want you to speak on this as well, but one thing that I noticed is that the way media and politicians in America frame what's happening in Palestine is that they never mention the oppression and the displacement of Palestinians as the initial act of violence. So what they do is they'll say Hamas is doing this or doing that, and that'll be the first act of violence, and Israel has every right to respond. Is that something that you've noticed?
Yeah, just even with the whole history of and the whole framing of the story, like that's like the main thing. Whenever you look at like any kind of situation, you got to go to the, like, as far back as you can find, like history-wise, and see how this became what it is. And if you go back even before 48, there was Palestinians being displaced. Like, I forget the exact number, but there was a lot of Palestinians that were displaced even before 48, because there was migration. Like I said, like Herzl, mm-hmm. he had been on this Zionist plan and everything since the 1890s. So there have been small colonizations and like little movements of Jewish people coming in. But by 48, they literally just came in and like, just,
that's when, like, that's when it destroys like a million, right?
Yeah, like over 750,000 or something. They was putting dynamite on houses. There's a book, this one, Ethnic Cleansing of Palestine.
Wow. Yeah, I wanted to get that too. I just read Mark Lamont Hill's. It was pretty decent. It was pretty kind of small, but I mean, it kind of outlined it, but it didn't go into great detail.
Yeah, this one, I haven't read that one, but this one definitely just, the it goes to like almost all the villages and how they took them, and it's all terrorism. So just going from the beginning to say like, oh, Israel is just defending itself, that's crazy, because how did they get there? You know what I'm saying? Right. There was Israel before 48. So like, you got to look at the whole thing to really see what's going on, mm-hmm. and see how the media is just picking sides based on the interests of, you know, U.S. politics and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and imperialism. And like, and so when we see, but isn't that evidence, like whenever we see somebody like Joe Biden as president, who they said was, you know, the very different from Trump. But we'll see, you know, Joe Biden say that I fully support Israel. Isn't that kind of evidence that, like, as far as politics goes, when it comes to U.S. imperialism, racism, and white supremacy, they're all going to be on board with it.
Yeah, it's just info. It's two teams. Like, I think Julius Nyerere used to say that America, so they got two parties, but it's just, you know, one party basically, and mm-hmm. It's just infighting between different sections of the ruling class.
Right, right.
And as far as the American ruling class goes, they are all in lockstep together on supporting like Zionism. So like, whether it's Trump, who people are saying was like the worst, or Biden, who people are like, oh, he's the lesser evil, they both are like hardcore pro-Israel all the way. Like Joe Biden gave the eulogy at what's his name? One of the old Palestinian prime ministers. And like, when Joe Biden was vice president, he went and gave the eulogy in Israel. And this guy was known for like, I think it was Ariel Sharon, I want to mm-hmm. say. It might be somebody else, so I might be wrong. Okay. But whoever the guy who we gave, the prime minister who gave the eulogy, yeah, this guy was known for like hoarding, breaking Palestinian bones, and like he was known for massacres, and you know what I'm saying? So like, but these are the people that get humanized, mm-hmm. like, lifted up by the West, no matter if it's Democrat, Republican, whatever. Mm-hmm. It's all like the same.
I saw a video the other day that where Biden literally said, when back earlier in his political career before he became president and vice president, but he it was a speech of him saying, "Hey, if there was no Israel, it would be our duty to create an Israel." And yeah, it's like, damn, I mean, I mean, he said it out of his own mouth, you know. Yeah, and
that's straight up just like, they serve our interests over there, so we need them, you know. That's didn't even hide it. Yeah.
Now, do the like some of those books about Palestine that you've read, do they speak about what the American interest is over there and why we are like, you know, why we spend so much money, like billions of dollars annually, and, you know, for military supplies and infrastructure, like why we spend so much money over there?
I mean, that's like a jump off base for us to do, especially in the last 20 or so years with all the different wars we have been, America's been starting over in the Middle East and whatnot. That's like a perfect strategic location, you know what I'm saying, to, like Malcolm says, sow division between Africa and Asia. And like, there's another book. Yeah, this one. So like, this is a perfect illustration of it. This book's called It's No Secret. It's like Israel's involvement in Central America or something. Mm-hmm. Basically, in like in the 80s during the Reagan era, down in Guatemala and a lot of different countries in Central America, there was gross like human rights abuses. Like they was genociding the Guatemalan generals. A lot of them trained by America was down there genociding native people, mostly Maya indigenous people, because they saw them as like prone to like communism and like revolution and all that. So that was like evil and like anti-Christian, they said, because a lot of these people were like fundamentalist Christians. A lot of the Maya indigenous people was mixed, like Catholicism mixed with indigenous religions. So it was demonizing them. And it talks about in this book how in like the 80s, the Congress started cracking down on who America was funding, because they were like, yo, there's all these, there's like genocide going on in Guatemala, and we see that America, we're sending all this money to them, all these weapons, we got to stop this. So Congress put a stop to it. But what America did was they said, let's just increase the money we send to Israel and just have Israel send them the weapons and everything. So Israel was sending Uzis and Galil rifles, and, you know what I'm saying? Because they have an arms industry too in Israel. It's pretty substantial. And so that when America can't send weapons to a regime that we like somewhere in the world that's helping us extract, helping America take out the resources from them, they just sent Israel to, like, you know, play the proxy.
Right. Okay. Yeah. I mean, that makes that, I mean, obviously that makes perfect sense. Now, I've historically, we've had everybody from Malcolm, Huey P., James Baldwin. We've had, Black people speak out on what's happening over there, right? And then, you know, within the Pan-African community or conscious community, we have different thoughts on different things at times, right? And I see some say, you know, that doesn't have anything to do with us over there. And, you know, we should just mind our business. Some also say, hey, they've never done anything for us, which is not necessarily true. Because I've researched things to where even here domestically, there have been Palestinian organizations that have donated real money to, organizations for Black people and our liberation. And, you know, even whenever during the protest for George Floyd, they were on Twitter telling Black protesters how to avoid being pepper sprayed, and if you're pepper sprayed, what to do, you know what I mean? And we see murals over there of George Floyd, by the way. But what are your thoughts on, people that say, hey, it's not our business, you know, we should just concentrate on us and what we got going on?
I mean, I disagree with that, because like I was saying a minute ago, whenever America U.S. whenever U.S. imperialism wants to do something, but they don't want to like do it themselves, basically, they get Israel to do it. And so if you look at all the backwards regimes that we done had in Africa in the 20th, 21st century, like Mobutu in the Congo, he was backed by Israel. If you look at Ethiopia under Selassie, he had a lot of backing from Britain, the U.S. and Israel, and going to the point of Palestinians like reaching out to Africans to help us and everything. In Ethiopia in the late 60s, early 70s, the Palestinian Liberation Organizations was training Ethiopian revolutionaries to try to overthrow that regime because they seen that America and Israel was backing the same regime in Ethiopia. So it's all like a
link. So the PLO was in Ethiopia training soldiers there to overthrow Selassie?
Yeah, I got the...
Wow, I didn't know that.
It's in this book right here.
What's that?
It's called Like Ho Chi Minh, Like Che Guevara. It's about Ethiopian left by Ian Scott.
Yeah, I need that.
But I forget what page. I ain't gonna try to find it right now. But yeah, sure. it had a section there. It was talking about how the PFLP, I think there was another one, the DFLP or something like that, and Fatah, Yasser Arafat's group, they was training Ethiopian revolutionaries in Syria, places like that, to go back into Ethiopia. You know what I'm saying? So there's definitely even been like that was material, like concrete support right there. But there's been, like you said, there's murals and, you know, by George Floyd. There's definitely a pretty good history of like back and forth collaboration.
If it was important enough for brothers like Malcolm, James Baldwin, the Black Panther Party, I think it's something that we should always pay attention to as well. You know what I mean? I will say this though, in researching our history the history of Black thought on Palestinian occupation, you know, and you just had a debate on do Abrahamic religions compromise African liberation. I have seen evidence that, you know, Christian leadership, including Martin Luther King, were pro-Israel. And I guess it was due to the fact that they were being funded or they knew that they could be cut off at any time.
That's what happened to Snake.
Yeah. No. Is that what you think it is? Is that the reason why that a lot of them were pro-Israel, is because they could be silenced or cut off if they showed support for Palestine?
Yeah, I mean, I would say that, and also, I feel like it probably wasn't as out there back then, because like Stokely Carmichael, he says in his autobiography, I'm pretty sure, that like at one point, he had, maybe it was a speech he had, but he says like at one point he thought like, I don't know if he said he was pro-Israel, but he wasn't anti-Zionist and all that. He didn't really know. And then it was Ethel Miner and SNCC wrote the position paper in like 67, I think they put out a...
Yeah, it was in 67. SNCC had a newsletter. I have it somewhere, but yeah, where they actually it's like 25 points where they outline what Zionism actually is.
Yeah, and that's when there's another book. Yes, it's called Black Liberation and Palestine Solidarity.
Mm-hmm.
Lenny Brenner and Matthew Quest. But it talks about here about the Martin Luther King issue. It acknowledges that he has some like, you know, pro-Israel sentiments and everything. But one of the main points it made was that basically the relationship between apartheid South Africa and Israel became very strong, but that was not, I don't know if they had an alliance like that in like 1965 through 68,
mm-hmm.
but by like 76, for instance, you had Voerster, who was the prime minister. I think it was Verwoerd, I don't remember. One of them V South African board apartheid dudes. Mm-hmm. They went up to Israel and got like the red carpet treatment. And this dude who went up there had been a Nazi during World War II. He had been a Nazi sympathizer, so the British put him in prison in South Africa as a Nazi supporter. And then Israel, by 76, they're welcoming him, you know what I'm saying? Like, because they saw themselves as similar, even back then, two apartheid states, like they saw themselves as being settlers.
Settler colonials.
Exactly. So like, but yeah, so, yeah.
What that kind of, that brings up something else that you were building about, man, hella interesting. And you posted a thread the other day about Zionist collaboration with Nazis, right? And just to even think about, I mean, saying that in a sentence doesn't, you know, like it sounds like an oxymoron, you know? And we were building earlier about, like you said, how 1890s is when Zionism actually became a thing. And so that kind of, that kind of shows and proves that if they did collaborate with Nazis, then it's not about religion. It's definitely a political thing. You know what I mean? And religion is just used as justification for what they do over there. But if you can, just give us a brief history of some of that Zionist collaboration with the Nazis. Because I think a lot of people don't really understand or know about that.
And I posted it today on it. It's called like 51 documents, Zionist collaboration with Nazis. Pretty sure. But like I was saying earlier, like before the Second World War, the majority of like Jewish people in the world weren't on board with Zionism. They saw it as, you know, for what it is, like some kind of like ultra nationalist, like not had nothing to do with Judaism, like some kind of weird new ideology, whatever. But what got a lot of basically there was certain Zionists, especially Zionist revisionists, which was led by a dude named like Jabotinsky or something like that. That was in that thread I posted the other day, but their whole thing was trying to ally with the Nazis or the fascist Italy, because they saw them as like also nationalist movements that also acknowledged the inherent difference of the Jewish people. You know what I mean? So like they could use Hitler and say, look, we're being persecuted in Europe. We got to go. So you better move on to Israel. You know what I'm saying? Like when that's not necessarily like the solution that or like to that kind of persecution and stuff. But so, yeah, there was arrangements between Adolf Eichmann, who was like the main mastermind behind the Final Solution, like the plan to just try to like genocide Jewish people. He was in collaboration with a dude named Kastner, I think his name was, out of Hungary. And basically the Zionists under this Kastner guy were sending, they was like, if we send y'all some trucks, will y'all let us take out like 20,000 Jewish people y'all was gonna exterminate, but we only want like the young ones that we can, you know, make use of. We don't really care about the poor. You know, it was real like sick, like just like trading their people off for like trucks and shit, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And only wanting to save the certain ones that they felt would be viable to build up the settler state in Palestine.
Damn. What's that book called again?
It's 51 Documents, Zionist Collaboration with the Nazis by Lenny Brenner.
Mm-hmm.
Who's he's the same dude that wrote this one right here.
Oh, okay.
He's a Jewish dude, but he's anti-Zionist. Mm-hmm. He was friends with Kwame Ture, so
that's how
I got put onto a lot of this was through listening to different speeches by him. So
yeah, that's dope. Yeah, because I have seen some certain people in the Jewish community come out and speak out against what's happening over there. And just last thing, one thing I saw, it was ill. I saw it this morning. It was a picture of a Jewish person over there in Palestine fighting with an assault rifle, right? Quote unquote, fighting for his home. But the fact of the matter is, the dude was from New York. He was a Jew from New York and had just started living there like 2 years ago, but, you know, feel like he has more rights than the people that have been displaced. I mean, that's a sickness, bro. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Nah, I've seen, there was like a, some video on like Vice News a long time ago, like mm-hmm. 5 years ago or something. I remember there was a similar thing where there was this this white dude over in Israel. Yeah, he was over and he was talking about how like this is his land, but he had like a thick New York accent. Like he looked like he was just straight like from New York. And he's talking about this is my land, right. blah, blah, blah. But then like a Palestinian, like, so you can be a Jewish person from New York, never been over, but you can just go whenever you want, steal a house, claim it. But yeah. if you're a Palestinian person that who's like, let's say you're like an elderly Palestinian person kicked out, was raised, born there, they can't go back. But you, mm-hmm. as like a New Yorker, you know, that don't make no sense. Like,
yeah, you got to have a pass to even get into certain places within the land yeah. your forefathers, you know, were from. It's crazy. I want to move the conversation to another topic that I saw you building on before the debate that you had. And you were building on, you had a critique of Chancellor Williams' work, the destruction of Black civilization. I think it's something that, you know, most of us have read once we start on that path to consciousness. Hold on 1 second. And so, yeah, you were building on a critique of Chancellor Williams. And it, like I said, it's something that I feel like most of us who got on that path have read. And I don't take it as disrespect if we correct those who came before us on certain topics, because in a lot of cases, they didn't have the information available that we had, right? And so I don't take a lot of things as disrespect when it comes to correcting information. I know some do. But, you know, just for those who are watching, this isn't about, you know, any type of disrespect of those who came before us, but it is our job and our duty to, critique all information that we get to make sure it's right and exact. So from your research, what did Chancellor Williams get wrong in destruction of Black civilization?
Yeah, so I think originally I was put on to some of the issues with the, like, even just reading it, mm-hmm. like, some things didn't sound like, there's a lot of good information in the book. Some things just, especially when it came to the subject of Islam, mm-hmm. I just didn't sound right to me, like, even before I had, like, more knowledge on it. Mm-hmm. And there was a dude on Twitter named, I think his name was Hakeem Muhammad, I think that's his name. Mm-hmm. But he was sharing a lot of information on, a specific thing that I remember he put me up on was, if you go to like the intro of Chancellor Williams' book, he talks about how his field research was arranged by the U.S. State Department, and like that right there, like.
All right. So you said if you can repeat that one more time.
In the intro, he says that his field research was arranged by the U.S. State Department, and like when the dude was pointing this out on Twitter, it did sound kind of seem odd that the U.S. State Department, especially in the time period of like, you know, 60s, early 70s, I think the book came out 74, mm-hmm. Why they would be interested in, you know, getting information on destruction of Black civilization. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, it seemed to me that the main issue was just his takes on Islam as this foreign religion that came in and destroyed Black civilization. Mm-hmm. And that was nothing but like a slave trade religion, mm-hmm. and of the white Arab, he'll say, you know, stuff like that, and just getting more information on the history of Islam in Africa. I don't see it as a destructive, like, negative force at all. Some of like the greatest civilizations in Africa was Islamic civilizations and whatnot. And going further than that, I see Islam itself as being an African product. I don't see it as like a foreign import, because as like Charles Finch, Ali Mazrui go over, the Middle East technically is like Africa's Northeast extension, both, you know, like geologically, language wise, everything. And
I didn't mean to cut you off, Jay, but what are your thoughts on like why? All right, so the narrative that Islam was. The narrative that Islam was something that was imposed on all African societies that practiced it, like with the sword. Is that something that you bear witness to, or do you feel like from your research that as far as some you know, societies that dealt with Islam, you know, such maybe Mali, the Mali Empire, do you feel like Islam was imposed on our ancestors strictly through the sword and nothing else, or was it more nuanced than that?
I would say it was definitely more nuanced, because like Diop, for instance, he talks about in pre-colonial Black Africa how the invasion, like the Islamic invasions, happened in North Africa, but he says as far as going south of the Sahara Desert, that never happened. It's just like, he calls it a figment of like sociologist imagination or something like that. Mm-hmm. But basically the way Islam spread, and Du Bois attested this, like Basil Davidson, like a lot of, there's Count Edward Blyden, mm-hmm. They attested this, that Islam spread through the majority of Africa peacefully through like either merchants, like, or a holy man would wander down, you know what I'm saying? And then they would convert maybe like a king or somebody else. And then that, then for the most part, Islam was spread by other Africans after those initial encounters within like places like West Africa, East Africa, things like that. And but yeah, like this is the book that I was posting from mainly.
Yeah,
on.
I saw that. I had never seen that before. At first, who wrote that?
It's by Amin Yasir Muhammad.
Mm. Okay. And he's kind of making the case that Islam was not completely given to us with the sword, and it was of our own volition.
Yeah, and he basically he lays the case out that like he lays out basically like what Chancellor Williams is arguing for, mm-hmm. the most part regarding Islam, and then he lays out other scholars that say things that don't really fit with that, like Diop, Du Bois, J.A. Rogers, Basil Davidson, Ivan Van Sertima. There's a lot of people he quotes in here. And then he just goes into some of the background on like thinking about the State Department and things like that, and why possibly the State Department would have a motivation, or why this, like what the motivation would be too, because if you look at the time period, the early 70s, there was a whole Arab-Israeli war, there was a whole oil embargo. Edward Said talks about in his book Orientalism how anti-Arab propaganda, anytime there's like a war like that, especially nowadays with the war on terror too, is still relevant. How that kind of feeds in, how like, yeah, basically how this kind of would feed into that. And not only that, but how, in my personal opinion, how it's geared toward Black people to try to divide, you know, a divide and conquer type of strategy, yeah. Like the same stuff Malcolm X talked about with Israel and everything else. Just because Malcolm also was real big on internationalism and mm-hmm. Not even just Africa, but with like Vietnam, like mm-hmm. the Arab world, everything. So I feel like a book that kind of tries to say that the Islam has had the same negative impact as like Europeans did in Africa and Christianity did is like, I don't agree with that. I feel like European systems were way more detrimental to Africa than
And one thing. So this book here, Medieval West Africa, is a dope book, and it's actually, so it's medieval Arab scholars merchants and travelers, and the documents that they wrote down whenever they actually came to these West African kingdoms that were, and so most of these West African kingdoms that they came across were Islamic. But the interesting thing that I see, like in that book, is they said that we weren't quote unquote true Muslims, but it wasn't because we were Black, it's because we practiced it the way we wanted to practice it. Which tells me, if you look at our history in America, with Noble Drew Ali and the Moorish Science People of America, Elijah Muhammad and the Nation of Islam, like that's what we do. We practice it in a way that works for us. You know what I'm saying? And that's what they did then, which kind of lets me know that if it was, you know, if everything was from the sword, then, you know, why do they still have these African customs? Because they didn't give up their African customs. Well, you know, a lot of these medieval kingdoms didn't give up their African customs at all. A lot of times, even whenever they became Muslim, they weren't taking the Shahada. It was just something that they did or said. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, if you haven't read that, I definitely think that you would enjoy that, because you can kind of see it from their own words that, hey, you know, they were powerful nations, and they were doing what they wanted to do, and the way they practiced Islam wasn't necessarily the same way that the Arab did.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to get that. Is that, it probably has like Ibn Battuta and stuff in it.
Yeah, and it's written by Nehemiah Letzian. He's one of the authorities, in my opinion, on medieval West Africa, Islam in West Africa. So it's pretty dope. But yeah, and so that's a powerful topic, just because, you know, within the Pan-African community, there's a lot of debate, and it's been for a while, you know, is Islam have a negative impact on our community? And in America, I don't see a case being made for that, because, you know, just the different nations that were created, you know, like I said, such as the Nation of Islam, more Science Temple of America. And then we even know that the accounts of slave traders, whenever they got Muslim enslaved Muslim Africans, like, they were the hardest to deal with. And you know what I'm saying? Like, as far as...
This book right here, mm-hmm. I know I'm bringing up a lot of books, but...
that's what we love here, man.
Servants of Allah. It's about... Dioff, I think is the name of the author. But one interesting thing that I read in here, I was going through this a couple weeks ago, was one of the first slave revolts in the Americas was in 1522 in Hispaniola, mm-hmm. and it was led by Wolof Muslims from West Africa.
Wow.
So, and it talked about how within the first 50 years that Spain had a foothold over here in the New World or whatever, back in them days, they passed, like, I think 5 separate pieces of legislation against African Muslims, because they were the most hard to deal with as far as like the revolts and things like that. And like no other religion like was specifically targeted like that by Spain in these early years. And it also went back to the Crusades and the Moors and everything else, mm-hmm. why they had such an aversion to African Islamic practice and everything, because that was one of their main enemies. You know, like the Moors was conquering Spain for like 700 years. So, and then right after that, 1492 is when they started doing that.
You're right. And so that, I think that says a lot, the fact that they sit, and I mean, that's some powerful history right there, but I think that says a lot for them to be singled out as being, you know, hard to control, you know what I mean? It kind of lets you know that they didn't lose their self-respect, their integrity. They didn't lose their will to fight for what they, you know, believed in. Not saying that, you know, that's not a knock on any other religion or anybody else's.
No, because a lot of times, and a good example, like earlier you was talking about how like, basically like the synchronicity between Islam and traditional African religions. And there's a book. This book right here is called Islam in Tropical Africa. It's like a bunch of like professors wrote like little articles as well. But this one professor named J.S. Trimingham, who Wesley Muhammad cites in his book too.
Okay.
He says, just as various religious strata. Okay, he says, Islam came on the scene, there was no feeling that it was incompatible with an African religious outlook. And he talks about, this is from a part of the book, we were talking about West Africa and how Islam kind of was incorporated and they didn't like throw away old traditions. Yeah. It was mixed in. But like another example, hold up, I got a lot of books over here. this one, Slave Rebellion in Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
It's about a Muslim uprising in Bahia, Brazil in 1835.
Wow.
And he talks about how even though it was the Muslim enslaved Africans that was leading it in Brazil,
mm-hmm.
and that was the largest urban slave uprising that took place in a city or whatever in the Americas. But it was led by these, they called them Malis, mm-hmm. Which was like mostly, I think, Yoruba.
Okay.
They were Muslim Yorubas and Hausas mainly. But they incorporated all various other ethnic groups who were non-Muslim too into this uprising, because even the other ethnic groups, they saw the Muslim Africans as a lot of them were illiterate. They spoke Arabic and read wrote, and they seen them as maybe having like some kind of higher connection or something. Like even if they weren't Muslim, they said, "Oh, his magic might be, you know, that might work. I might have to try that out in this uprising we got." You know what I'm saying? So like, they were very influential. Even going to Haiti, one of the main Maroon leaders, Mackendall,
mm-hmm.
he read and wrote Arabic. He was a Muslim, wow. And that was before the Haitian Revolution.
Wow.
Some people even argue that Bookman, the name Bookman comes from being a person of the book, because he was from Jamaica originally, or not originally, he was from Africa, but he was in Jamaica, and people have argued that he got the name Bookman from being a person of the book, being a Muslim. And even though he led a voodoo ceremony in Haiti, that just even further shows the synchronicity, how you can right. be, you know what I'm saying, Bookman, presumably known to being a man of the book and also leading this other spiritual tradition.
Yeah, that's dope. That's real dope. Thank you for that, bro. And so for those that might not be tapped in yet, with the music, you're also an MC. Your subject matter is on some real shit. You drop a lot of jewels. You show lyricism. Like these days, what inspires your music, man? Like, you know, what inspired you to pick up the pen?
I mean, like, my dad's a musician, and so I've always been around music. I played piano, played saxophone growing up. I was in little bands and whatnot as a kid. But I got into hip hop more like, as a kid too, but the type of hip hop I was listening to was mainly like, I was drawn to Tupac, Gangstar, you know what I'm saying, like Boom Bap, like RZA, you know, and things that like, didn't feel like I was listening to a lecture, but like they dropped information and it was like in a good, in a cool way, you know what I'm saying? So like, I've always been in like Boom Bap hip hop, like soul sample type, you know, more lyrical hip hop. And that's pretty much what I try to make, is just like same type of stuff I like to listen to. Like,
are you working on anything now?
Yeah, I got it.
Because I heard that the Pete Sampras joint, and that's dope. And for those who don't know, you can find that on Apple Music and Spotify.
Yeah, and I got two different projects I'm working on right now. One is with the same dude that produced that Pete Sampras. We got about like 4 or 5 songs we're working on, and what I'm doing with that one. Like I said, my dad was a musician back in the day, like in the 70s and shit. So I'm sampling like his old songs to make new songs, which I never heard nobody do that before, sample like their own family members' old stuff to make new stuff. So I'm doing that with that one. And then I got another tape with a dude named Talon that I'm working on, who I've already made a couple different projects with. But yeah, I'll probably release some new stuff within the next month or two.
Dope. And so what do you know, being a fan of music, and I didn't know you play instruments. That's dope. Like, are you into jazz or anything like that as well?
Yeah, I like to play the blues a lot. I mainly play by ear, but like I was, like initially I did take lessons when I was real young, and then I kind of just started playing on my own and figuring stuff out. So mainly I play by ear, but yeah, I'm real into I like the blues. I like to play the blues a lot.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, and that's, you know, so many different forms of music derived from blues music, you know what I'm saying? It's crazy. And blues music came from our pain and oppression, you know what I'm saying? And it's like one of the the most powerful genres of music there is.
There's a good book on that, Blues People by Amir Baraka. He talks about also like the how it's like a black genre from like with African roots and everything. Mm. How basically every popular music genre in America pretty much comes from black people, black music.
Wow, and I mean, shit, it's true, you know what I'm saying? For those, for one, I want to say I definitely appreciate you for coming on. I think it was a very informative bill, man, and, you know, I definitely can't wait for the people to see it. For those who are, you know, want to get tapped in with the music, also, you know, want to find you on social media, can you let everybody know, you know, where to find your music and how to find you on social media?
Yeah, I'm on Twitter at Dab Squad Slank, DAB Squad _ Slank, and SoundCloud is just SoundCloud / Slank. Yeah, like you said, I got some stuff on Apple Music, Spotify. Yeah, that's about it.
For sure, man. Well, so I want to say I definitely appreciate you for coming on, bro.
Yeah, thank you for having me on here too. I appreciate it. It was a good conversation. Mm-hmm.
No doubt, man. No doubt. So I definitely want to, you know, as just building the show, man, I'm definitely enjoying, you know, meeting new brothers and sisters who are like-minded and, you know, just having these conversations and having the people learn from them, you know what I mean? And, you know, not about egos, just all about liberation of our people. Cause you know, the first thing that we got to liberate is our minds, you know what I'm saying? So I would definitely like to have you back on, you know what I'm saying, sometime and you know, just keep the bill going.
Yeah, I'm there. And again, I appreciate it. Thanks for having me on.
For sure, man. You have a good one, bro.
You too.
Peace.